I don't know what to tell you. Just because I only had time to put them together. But one of the things about climate change, well, a few things about climate change, it's not all about humans and burning fossil fuels. And there's actually some natural climate change that goes on. But actually, I'm going to end with emphasizing the role that humans have played. And I really think that the verdict is in from scientists anyway, and that humans have, because of our activity, have been doing things that make our temperatures warmer. And one of the things making our temperatures warmer is that our ice melts. Well, no kidding. Okay. So kind of a preface to this chapter, a few things. Remember when we talk about climate versus weather, climate is like a 30-year average, and it's a rolling average. So, you know, we look at the last 30 years. Next year, we'll look at the last 29 years plus next year, okay? So I don't know if that made sense, or this year, I guess. One of my pet peeves or one of my concerns is when people, we have a really hot day, and somebody say, oh, there's global warming, or the other one really makes me mad. We'll have a cold day. We'll have a cold spell, and they'll say, oh, what about that global warming? And I'm like, dude, the weather for a given day is not climate change. Either way. It does feel like global warming in this room. So anytime you see BY, that's it's not bring your own. It's billions of years ago. Okay, so one of the things we talk about, and I think we talked about it in this class too, but we talk about astronomy, is how old is this our solar system? How old is the Earth? It's about 4.6 billion years old. Okay, and climates have been changing since that time. We'll kind of talk about the climate changes even before there were humans here. So it is apparent that man's influence is a major contributor to what we see going on now. And this last one, and I'll kind of remind you on the last slide, that changes that we make today with how humans do business, with our emissions or our handling of agriculture, changes we make now are going to be, we're going to see a delayed effect, hopefully a positive effect. So we talked about these spheres. I don't know if you remember back in Unit 1, the geosphere, the atmosphere, okay, geosphere, atmosphere, hydrosphere, that's water, right? Biosphere, that's life. And cryosphere, I don't know how much we talked about that, but the cryosphere is ices. And with global warming and melting of the ices, of course, the cryosphere is a player when we kind of look at climate's changing right now anyway. The system is complicated, okay? So the climate system is complicated. Actually, near the end, we're going to see that, you know, just like we have, we try to forecast what the weather's going to be like tomorrow, scientists, climatologists, are trying to forecast what the climate will be like in 100 years. So this is kind of a glance at all kind of the different things we have going on, how they interact with each other. I kind of thought today while I was getting this lecture ready about the butterfly effect. Can you remember, like, a butterfly in South America flaps its wings and it has consequences for the weather that day here in North America? Well, what if you take the butterfly effect on steroids, okay? Or what if you take the butterfly and not only have it flap its wings today, but it flaps its wings, like, instead of not flapping its wings, it flaps its wings for the next 100 days. I don't know how long butterflies live. Or what if you have, instead of one butterfly, what if you have like 1,000 butterflies? It sounds like a creepy science fiction movie. But they all kind of, you know. So it's complicated. Oh, I meant to print this off for you. Sorry, guys. But I decided this semester to kind of take a look at the kind of the different, make sure I get this right word, right. The different eons. Eon is the broadest term. Eras, periods, and epochs of kind of the Earth. So when you look at this, you have to realize that this Precambrian is right here. So they're kind of ran out of room. This whole segment kind of goes underneath there. Okay, so that's old stuff. So they're on the, let's see, make sure I got this right. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. So eons, check this out. So the Precambrian, there are actually three eons there. There's this one, Hadean. There's this one, however you pronounce that. Okay. And then, I missed one. There's the A one. So there's the three eons that are all part of the Precambrian era. Okay. The fourth eon is actually, we are in the fourth eon. We are in the Phanerozoic eon. So then this blue right here is all of this stuff. So actually then, we're in that era, or excuse me, we're on that eon, okay? And then it's broken down into eras. There's this P era, Mesozoic era, Cenozoic era. We are in the Cenozoic era. More specifically, it's broken down into periods. We are in the Quaternary period, and more specifically, we're in the Holocene epoch. Now, if you go to the Natural Museum of Science or Natural Museum of History, they will talk about all of these. Okay? So, I kind of wanted to do that to kind of put in perspective this idea. So again, I wish I'd kind of printed it out. It's kind of small for you to kind of go back and forth to. But if you go back and think just the most recent eon, okay? Just the most recent eon. And that gives you 542 million years of time. On the next slide, you're going to kind of see this going warm and then kind of going cold, okay? So actually, it's done warm and then cold a couple of times in our current eon without humans being there. And I think this is so cold. This is so cool, excuse me. So this is going to be temperature over here on the y-axis and time over here along the x-axis. When it was warm, check this out. There was like bananas growing in Wyoming. Okay, and there were palm trees growing in Wyoming and bananas growing in Oregon. Okay, so during these warm periods in Earth's history, there was little to no ice sheet. And basically, from the equator up, we had kind of this tropical kind of climates. I just think that is so cool. Well, this is in one of the kind of the cold periods. So you're kind of looking cockeyed. This is the North Pole, and you've probably kind of maybe even seen evidence of kind of the glaciers or the ice sheets going down over North America and then retreating. Okay, so I think we might be covered by an ice sheet there, guys. Okay. So that would be during the cold period. So, yeah. This is the most recent era, I want to say. Okay, and you catch kind of only one cycle of the several times that this has gone up and down. You're going to see kind of several times here in a minute. So this would be hot here, and this would be cold here. So when I looked at this, I'm like, oh my gosh. So we are actually kind of finishing out a cold cycle where we actually in a polar area have some ice sheets. And, you know, lest we think that kind of this warming hasn't gone on, this whole warming and cooling has gone on kind of like clockwork for the last 800,000 years. Every 100,000 years, it switches. And we aren't due quite yet for another warm-up, but we are warming up. So, paleoclimatology is somebody who studies climates from a long time ago. So it's hard to study climates from a long time ago, especially when there aren't any historic records. People weren't around to leave historic records. So we're going to look at different forms of proxy data. How do we infer or understand concretely what the atmosphere was like? It's called proxy data. So an example of proxy data would be obtained by, this looks like an oil drilling rig over here. Actually, that's a scientific drilling rig that will go to the bottom of the ocean floor and drill for a core. And so basically, the core that they bring up, what's on top of the core is the most recent dead body marine's life. And then going down is historically kind of layer after layer of marine life. So along the idea of marine life, that kind of pretty picture over there, these are single-celled marine creatures, organisms, that can tell a lot, whether they're present or absent, to understand what the climate was at the time that they were thriving. I just think that is so cool. One other important tool, not just in sediment cores like this, but also in ice cores, we can look at the oxygen. Now, oxygen, the symbol for oxygen is O. Of course, ozone is O3. But there's normal oxygen, which is oxygen 16. And then there's heavy oxygen, oxygen 18. Those are different isotopic forms. And the ratio of the heavy or special oxygen to the light oxygen is an indication of the temperature at the time. Well, that's kind of cool. So we have sediment cores and we have ice cores. So ice cores, if you watch the movie The Day After Tomorrow, that's when the dude, the beginning, the first scene, the ice sheet kind of cracks because they're getting their ice cores. I mean, no one died there, but it was close. So there's where you see that fancy oxygen, the oxygen 18. Okay, so they can kind of understand what the period, at that time that the deposit was made on the ice sheet, what the conditions of the atmosphere were like. Another thing they can see in these ice cores is, was there volcanic ash deposited at that time? And then another thing that they can get in the ice cores is actually they can extract gases that have been trapped all those years. I just think that is so cool. Okay, and you can imagine that sample recovery is very important. So when we talk about carbon dioxide in the atmosphere from way back when, a good source is these ice cores. So there's folks doing their ice core work. And then this is a storehouse full of ice cores. I'm telling you, the movie The Day After Tomorrow, Jack was in there when he was just working away. Climatologist. Okay, so going back 40,000 years, okay, in ice core, looking at getting temperature data from ice cores, this is kind of what we have going on. So this one's backwards, isn't it? Okay, more proxy data. If you want to put proxy data, you can at the top here. We can study tree rings. And of course, you know, each year a tree grows, it adds another ring. Kind of from the inside, the outside would be the oldest ring. And we can get a sense for growing conditions, which gives you climate information by kind of how healthy the ring is. Get a sense for... was there an issue with solar radiation that plant had? This tree down here is a tree is from California, and these trees, some of these are more than 4,000 years old. That's so cool. That's gnarly tree, but that is very cool. So there's more proxy data. More proxy data, just simply pollen. Now, a good way that pollen can be preserved, haven't you heard of these mummies that have been preserved like in bogs? And that is just so creepy. But honestly, along those lines, if you have a lake or some sort of shallow water like a bog, you can have the vegetation do their thing, spreading pollen everywhere, including the lake. And year after year, it actually will create layers that you can go ahead and get a core of that and get a sense for what sort of pollen there was way back when.
And if you see the pollen, if you can identify the pollen, I frankly don't know what each of those little cute little pollen things are, but if you can identify the pollen back to what the species is, you can understand what sort of growing conditions were, you know, were right for that species. So coral reefs, you know, that sort of thing. They're kind of like trees in that each year they put on a fresh layer, but I think they're different than trees because it would be, I'm pretty sure, at the edges instead of the heart of the coral, although I'd have to check that out. But we end up with these growth bands and kind of like the tree rings, you can actually get a sense for what the conditions were like for that coral for that particular year. So this is a look back from 1600 to 1950 of surface temperatures for the Galapagos Islands, the waters off the Galapagos Islands, looking at coral growth rings. Looks kind of noisy to me. So another, or talking about data that's not proxy data, so I called it non-proxy data. So that means it's direct, it's not indirect. So actually we do have some historic information. Your textbook says that good historic information would be when crops were planted and when they were pulled. That gives you information about the growing season. Floods, animal migration. But it cautions that kind of the people tend to, in their journals, write about the dramatic weather, and the dramatic weather is more anomalous. So that's not as helpful as kind of the day-to-day. All right, I guess we are going pretty fast here, but I still think it's going to take 2 segments. Okay, so in other classes, and maybe in high school, you have learned about or studied about the plate tectonics. So basically the way it works is that the Earth's, some point after 4.6 billion years, the Earth began cooling down. It's been cooling down ever since. But it became cool enough so that instead of entirely being liquid, it formed a crust. And so that crust even now moves about on, I put the word liquid in parentheses because the liquid mantle underneath the crust is more of a, it's more of a plastic than it is a liquid. So these slabs of crust move around on liquid mantle. So I'm going to show you, or you can see on the next slide, a figure of showing you basically these crusts used to be together so that all of the land masses of the Earth were one big supercontinent called Pangaea. And then they started moving apart and creating the continents that we know separated by oceans. So as they moved apart, then actually as they moved towards the poles, they became colder. They moved towards the equator, they became warmer. So as they moved, actually they had a climate change for these. So at the top there, you can kind of already see some breaks in Pangaea. And then kind of here at the bottom, B, that actually is kind of what the continents look like today. It's a very slow process. But one of the things that they can tell is that when glaciers move, so I'm going to kind of circle Pangaea up here, okay? When glaciers move, they create tracks. So actually, there are tracks on Antarctica that match up with South America and Africa and India. So here's Antarctica, South America, Africa, India, Australia. So they match up because they were once together. So the other thing I say up there is plate tectonics also can build mountains over the course of time. And, of course, one of the things we know about mountains is they're a player in weather. And if they're a player in weather, then they're playing the 30-year average of climate. So, for instance, orographic lifting and kind of channeling weather, wind patterns. Okay. So far, this has all been natural ways of climate change. Here's another natural way of climate change.
volcanoes going off. I think we talked about this before, like a few years ago, Greenland volcano went off and it put up a lot of sediment that actually grounded planes for a significant time. So there's Mount Etna in 2002, and this one is Hawaiian Island in 1970. So as we're talking about climate change, two things. The volcanoes put out sediment or aerosols that actually can block incoming solar radiation and have a cooling effect. This one over here is showing you, I think it's hard for you guys to see, but for two different volcanoes, okay, this one over here is the net solar radiation percent change. So it dipped down percentage-wise like 4.5% and 3.5%. So that's significant. We talked about VOG, V-O-G. VOG is volcanic smog. Okay. The other thing, I guess I see it on here, is that we're going to talk about carbon dioxide and how it actually, the presence of CO2 gas, acts as a greenhouse gas, and it has a warming effect. So volcanoes are great at burping all sorts of things, including carbon dioxide gas. All right. So along the lines of naturally changing our climates is this idea about the Sun-Earth system. So this first one goes with this one right here. I think we talked about perigee and apogee. Okay, we said that actually, we said that if this is the sun and if this is the Earth orbiting the sun, oops, should go counterclockwise, sorry. Counterclockwise, okay. We said that sometimes the Earth is closer to the sun, we call that perigee, and sometimes the Earth is farther from the sun, we call that apogee. So actually, in that sort of kind of oval nature of the path of Earth's orbit is called eccentricity. So as it varies, so also our proximity varies to the sun, and that can have a change in the amount of solar radiation we get. So over here, for each one of these diagrams, it says how long it takes to complete one cycle. So to complete one cycle of kind of changing eccentricity, so our distance changes, so this changes, it's about 100,000 years. So the next one is obliquity. Obliquity. That actually is kind of shown here in this figure, right here. Now, earlier in this class, I think you'll probably see on the test, said that the Earth's axis of rotation is tilted 23.5 degrees. But there's a little bit of play in that, and that cycle lasts about 41,000 years. So actually, instead of 23.5 degrees, which you should answer on your final exam, it actually varies from 22 to 44.5. And as it varies, it has consequences to climates on Earth. And then the last one is precession. It's one of my favorite. Precession is, a lot of times we'll call it a wobble. Okay. And basically, this is showing that it's keeping the same tilt angle, 23.5 degrees, but it's wobbling. It makes what we call kind of a coning action. And this has a neat consequence in astronomy, because as the axis of rotation kind of wobbles, then it points to a different pole star. So that's awesome. So that actually takes about 26,000 years. Now, the Milankovic cycle basically kind of looks at all three of these, eccentricity, obliquity, and precession, and it says, you know, there are some kind of hot spots based upon how long it takes to complete each one of those cycles. Okay. All right. So solar variability. Again, the movie The Day After Tomorrow, they all got together in NASA and was like, okay, is the sun doing anything different? Well, to create the conditions in the movie, the sun does do different things. A little bit.
Notice that it varies about 0.1% solar output for about an 11-year cycle. So you've probably heard of coronal mass ejections. You've probably heard of sunspots. Those are things associated with an active sun. And so as the sun is active, it puts out a little more solar energy. So this down here, you can kind of see the up, the down, the up, and the down, the up, the down. That is about an 11-year cycle from solar max to solar max, about 11 years. And the way they kind of track is the sun being active or minimum, or active or inactive, is they look at sunspots. So here's a picture of sunspots. This actually kind of looks like a sunspot group. And these two pictures are like taken at the same time of the sun, different energies, different wavelengths. Actually, this is in a wavelength to kind of see the electromagnetic flux lines that are coming out of the sun. This slide says that, and this isn't one, but if the slide has a crazy burp, they call that a coronal mass ejection. And that actually, we might have talked about this before, it sends charged particles, and if the Earth is in sight of the direction of the emission, then those charged particles will actually hit the Earth's atmosphere, which is usually okay. A really big one could really put our power lines down, though. So the Earth takes the brunt of the shock usually, and then it kind of cascades the particles down through the poles, and it gives us a northern and southern lights called auroras. I just think that is so cool. Well, this one, you guys don't have this slide, do you? But you have this slide, right? Okay. I'll let you write it down, and then we'll take a break. I'm going to clear our palette. But we're doing good. Okay?